Hello, today we look at the slipped capital femoral epiphysis. And this is a very interesting disease because it is standing for something related to the hip. It's a non-traumatic hip disease. This means that the patient comes with no trauma. That is, he did not hurt himself. And this is an epiphyseal solution. What does this mean? We know that the bone of your lower leg have different parts. We have the femur, which is the lower leg, have some metaphysis, it have epiphysis, and then this epiphysis will be dislocated in this disease. And we have some names. We say here slipped capital femoral epiphysis, but we also have a name called coxa vara. We can also say epiphyseolysis capitis femoris, which is a Latin name. And then we have our American type of slipped capital femoral epiphysis. Epidemiology just means how common is this disease in the world. And we can see that it is the most common hip disease in teenagers. Please notice, most common hip disease in teenagers. This means up to 1 in 10,000. That means if you look at the city, let's say a city have 1 million persons, how many patients do you have then? That means we have to divide 1 million by 10,000. So it will be how much? Around 100 children will have this in a city of 1 million. So it's the most common, please remember, the most common hip disease in teenagers. And when does the slipped capital femoral epiphysis appear? It appears in puberty. This means not older people. It is the age of 11 to 13 years of age. And it is more common in boys or girls. What do you think? It's more, two times more common in boys. So here we have a very beautiful picture showing that we will have a typical guy coming in. It's a boy, two times more often in the doctor's office. The mean age will be around 13.5 for guys and for girls around 12. And we will discuss why this difference is here. How long after the first slip does the second slip in the other hip develop? What do you think? So we get the slip in one hip. How long does it take for the slip to get into the other one? Because many patients will have a slip in both hips. It takes 18 months. 18 months. That means if you get this diagnosis, you can expect the disease appearing in your other hip also in about 1.5 years. The pathology means that we are looking at the process of this disease. And the first question we ask, when does this disease not appear anymore? And this is after the closure of the growth joint. Growth joint is the part of the joint where it is growing. So during puberty, this area will grow a lot. And we have an age of around 12 in girls and 13.5 in boys where this joint actually closes. And from that point, this disease cannot appear anymore. So here we see the growth of the joint. We have three pictures, one in a child, one in teenager, and one in adult. And you see in adults, this bone is already really, really strong. In the middle one, it's still growing. And this is the most common cases here. In teenagers, we have a growing bone, and therefore we will have this disease because it's, as we said, this epiphysis part, as you can see, this upper part will slip, because this growing phase will cause a weakening of this bone, and therefore it can slip. In adults, it's already so strong that it cannot slip anymore. The bone is intact. And by which females is the likelihood of the disease very low? As we said, after menarche, after this girl have reached menstruation period, because then the growing phase of this bone is closed. Here we have a picture of that, so you remember it. And by which males is this disease very unlikely? We have after the fourth Tanner stage, just remember, after the guys are around 13.5 years of age, that's all you have to remember. The fourth Tanner stage just shows you which guys are actually around 13.5 years of age. Those who have this characteristic, and you can classify boys into Tanner stages 1 to 5, and you can check this in another video or check this on internet what this actually means. How does somatotropin affect epiphyseal joints? Why is this important? We have some hormones. Somatotropin is a hormone. And we said that in girls and in boys, we have a difference of age. And we will come now to the conclusion why. Somatotropin is a sex, these are all hormones, and we have some sex hormones like testosterone and estrogen also that will affect the growth of the bones. And somatotropin will increase the strength of the bone. Estrogen, in the other hand, will also increase strength, but it will also close the joint. So this is the interesting case here, you see. The girls have more estrogen in their body, and therefore the joint will close earlier, which means that the disease cannot happen anymore. Therefore, this is the main message I have. In girls, we have estrogen that closes bones, and therefore they are not having the disease as long period as guys have. 13.5 for guys, 12 for girls, as we said. How does testosterone affect the epiphyseal joints? Increases growth. So we have a guy who is growing a lot and reduces strength. Here you see the second argument for guys and girls being a difference here. Two times more common in boys. Why? Because we have more testosterone in guys, and they will increase in growth and they will decrease in strength, in bone strength. So whenever a guy tells you proudly that he has a lot of testosterone and he is so strong, he has strong bones, that's not true. Girls have more strength in their bones than guys do. How does thyroxine affect the epiphyseal joints? It will reduce the activity, and leptin is another hormone, and it will widening the joints. And then we have leptin being proportional to fat. Why is this important? Because this typical patient that comes in is a boy, as we said, with a lot of fat. So it's a fatty boy, because the fatty boy have a lot of leptin. And as we saw in the previous question here, it's widening of the epiphyseal joint. And if we are widening something, it's getting less strong. It's getting a reduced strength. And therefore, you have this slipped capital femoral epiphysis. What happens during puberty? We said sex hormones increase, we have widening of the joint, and we have thinning of this perichondrial fibrous ring. And these three factors then together will cause a weakening and then cause this disease. Why are boys more affected than girls? We have a longer growth period also. Yeah, so this is actually related to these hormones, as we said. Longer growth period for guys than girls. And we have lower estrogen levels, as we said, and it is hereditary. We should remember that the disease is hereditary and it is autosomal dominant. This means that, for example, if your father is affected, the mother is normal, then we will have, out of four children, we will have two children affected and two not. Or we can say out of two children, we have one affected and one not. So 50%. Autosomal dominant will have an hereditary of 50%. Let's look at diagnosis. Do you know what diagnosis means? Diagnosis just means that we are looking for the cause of the disease. We're finding the cause of the symptoms that the patient appears with. So the patient comes in and we need to find the diagnosis of this patient. And we can look at the symptoms first. So the patient will look like this. Without trauma, we ask him, did you fall down? No, he had no trauma. He's a male, we said two times more common. He's overweight. Because fat, you know, increase leptin, you know, increase leptin, increase the widening of the joint, which decreases strength. So overweight, teenager, we said this is happening in the growth phase, fast growing, yeah, so the fast growing phase, hip pain, but I want to emphasize here that the patient does not only complain about hip pain, he can also complain about knee and thigh pain. And why is this so important? We have a disease here that is affecting the hip. And then the patient comes in and complains about knee pain or thigh pain. Then you directly think of another disease, some knee disease. No, there can actually be knee pain and thigh pain in a patient with a hip disease. That's very unusual to think of, but this is the case. And this guy now will come, he's a boy, he's fatty, he has, let's say, knee pain or hip pain. And he's overweight, as you see, and he complains of, let's say, both of knee and hip pain, or he complains of only hip pain, or he complains of only knee pain. So there are many, many different types of patients here. What increases the pains? We will ask him, What can you do to increase the pain and what can you do to reduce the pain? Increase, he will say, whenever I'm walking, I'm running, I'm doing any physical activity, I have increased pain. And then the characteristic of this pain will be, as we said, no trauma, but is non-radiating. This means that the pain is localized to one area. If he complains of hip pain, it's only hip pain. It's not radiating towards other parts of the leg. It's dull, so it's very dull because you can have many characteristics. A dull is that it's constantly a dull, non-radiating pain. The relief of the pain is when he rests. So he says that, yeah, I'm sitting on a couch or I'm laying in bed for an hour and then it's fine, then it's good. So remember that. Increased activity, increased pain. Decreased activity, decreased pain. What type of gait disturbances? Then we will ask him, can you please walk a little bit? And he will then walk antalgic gait. We'll look at what this means. Or he will have a Trendelenburg gait. Antalgic gait means that he have a short step on the affected side. Why? Because it's painful. So he's walking, let's say, on the right foot, then it's painful, then he only walks on this right foot very, very briefly, and then he has to switch to the left side quickly. So it's a short step on the affected leg, which is painful. That's antalgic pain. And this picture shows that he's having the whole body weight on the right side, and therefore it's painful, so he will quickly turn into the left side. The Trendelenburg gait means that when you stand on the affected leg, then the opposite hip is lower. And we can look at this like this. Look at the left leg. He's standing on the left leg. All the weight is put there. And interestingly, the hip of the right hip will then be lower. It will be turned like this. And this is typical Trendelenburg gait. And the upper body is then turned onto the left side. So this is Trendelenburg gait. What type of hip motion is decreased? We have decreased internal rotation of the leg. Then we have abduction problem, decreased abduction, and decreased flexion. And this can be illustrated with a picture that I don't have now. But internal rotation means that you are rotating the leg inwards. Abduction means that you cannot really move the leg outwards. Ab means outwards. Flexion means that, for example, if you look at my arm, this is flexion. This is something that you cannot do with your leg. So you cannot internal rotate. You cannot abduct. So abduct means that like this. And you cannot flex that of the leg. Good. What type of hip motion is normal? This is adduction. Adduction meaning toward the body. Abduction means from the body. So to the body, it's possible. That this is a picture of adduction. An abduction would be the opposite, so it would be pointing at the other direction, far from the body. So towards body adduction, that is normal. How long does it take on average from onset of symptoms until diagnosis? What do you think? So the patient comes in, we see the symptoms. How long do you think it takes for the doctor to say this is the disease diagnosis? 4 months. And why? Because not many doctors know this disease. Therefore, I'm doing this video. I want more doctors to know this disease. 4 months is very, very long. In a 4 month period, many, many things can happen, and that's very dangerous. What is the most common reason for doctors missing this disease? Recurrent knee pain. That means patient complains of knee pain. And then the doctors are totally lost because they cannot think of a hip pain disease when the patient complains of knee pain. So it takes them 4 months to figure it out. So in case of pain in the knee, please never forget the hip. That's my main message. And this is a doctor who is young, like me, who don't know the disease, have no clue. The patient comes with knee pain and he misses the diagnosis totally. And then we cannot treat it and then complications will appear. And we'll look at what type of complications. How many percent of patients do you think presents with knee pain or thigh pain? How many people come into the doctor's office with this knee pain? 15. That's really, really much. It's more than every 10 guy with this slipped capital femoral epiphysis coming in with knee pain. And the doctors miss this, and therefore it takes them 4 months. So please look at these pictures and remember that we can have this disease also. If the patient complains of knee pain, is the palpation of the knee tender? That's the question. So you put your hand on the knee. Does the patient complain of pain or not? No. And this is very strange also. So the patient complains of knee pain, but when you palpate it, when you put your hand on it, it does not hurt. The examination is totally normal. So imaging. We have now seen the symptoms. We need to check some imaging tools here, X-ray, MRI, and so on, because in that way we can really be sure of this disease. We can diagnose it. And the most important tool will be X-ray of the pelvis. So the pelvic area will be looked in an anterior-posterior view and from a lateral view, so from the side. So from in front of the patient and then from lateral. And these two views will be then checked by the doctor. We made this X-ray, and we will see three things can be seen. Not all things have to be seen, but three things can be seen in the X-ray in an anterior-posterior view. And one is a blurring of the junction between the metaphysis and physis. We said that we have different parts of the bone. We have a metaphysis part and we have a physis part. And there's a junction between them. And this will be a blurring between them. Then we have something called Blanch sign of Steele. We will look at what this means. And then we have a Klein's line. First of all, which of these three do you think is the most common that the doctor will see in X-ray? That's the blurring of the junction between the metaphysis and physis. And here we see what I just mentioned, epiphysis, physis, and we have a blurring of that. What is the Blanch sign of Steele? This is a semicircular area. We have an increased density in the neck region. And here we see that this is the Blanch sign of Steele, what we can see in X-ray. Klein's line is a line that we draw along a superior line on the femoral neck. And then if this intersects the femoral head, then it's normal. If it does not, then it's this disease. And here we can see what I mean. This femoral line here is what I'm talking about. You draw a line along that, and then if it intersects, like you can see here, then it's normal. If it does not, which means that the whole part here slipped, it slipped below this line, below this Klein's line, then you know that we have this disease. When should MRI be used? That is more expensive. X-ray is very cheap. You make it quick. MRI cost money. It takes more time. We should do it when we have a patient with symptoms and we want to detect this disease early. And on X-ray, we don't really see anything. We know that the symptoms are there for the patient. We know that we don't see really anything on X-ray. Then this is something called occult, which is something that means that we are not really sure if this disease, let's do an MRI. Let's pay the price and let's check this because this is important for the patient. Risk of avascular necrosis is the second argument for using an MRI. And avascular necrosis is a very dangerous disease, very, very dangerous disease. Necrosis means the total destruction of the bone, okay? Avascular necrosis, total destruction of the bone. MRI looks like this. You lay down, you go into this magnetic field, and then we will check the pelvic region and the hip. And what can we see? We will see a widening of the physis there, and we will see surrounding edema. That is something we can see with MRI very good. And here we see, this is the physis part, which is widened, okay? What can we see in X-ray more? We said these three signs, but there are also one more, I would say, which is very interesting to know. Ice cream slipping sign. Yes, you heard it correct. It's ice cream, and we have also normal widening and irregularity of the physis. But ice cream slipping sign is something you will remember, I think. If you look at the X-ray picture on the right, then I have marked with blue that this is like the ice cream is dropping off, so slipping off this femoral part. Okay, so that is, I think, one of the most characteristic picture of this disease. Classifications. How can we classify it? We have many types. I will mention five of them. We have pre-slip, acute, chronic. This is one classification type. We have stable, unstable, and we have mild, moderate, severe, typical or atypical, and unilateral or bilateral. And you can mix this as you want. You can say that this patient comes with an acute stable or acute unstable disease, which is severe and atypical and only unilateral. I used five classifications at the same time. So you can mix this all. And let's look at pre-sleep, acute and chronic. The definition of pre-sleep will be that we have a pain and widening of the physis, but no displacement of the epiphysis. So there's no ice cream slipping off. Okay, there's no displacement. And here we have widening of the physis, but no displacement. That means it's still intact. Definition of acute disease means that we have a duration of less than 3 weeks. We ask the patient, when did you have the symptoms? Yeah, it started yesterday or 1 week ago. Then we know it's acute, it's not chronic. We have joint diffusion here and often associated with trauma. We said that in this disease, it's not usually associated with trauma. This is true, but in acute case, there can be also a trauma related to it that triggered this disease, okay? So 3 weeks, remember that is acute. Definition of chronic is more than 3 weeks. So it's simple to remember. Acute, less, chronic, more. And here we have no joint effusion and no trauma usually. Chronic, it takes time. So more than 3 weeks. Acute on chronic means that we had a chronic and then suddenly we have an acute on top of that. How common is acute disease? Acute disease is around 10%. Chronic disease is around 75%. And acute on chronic diseases is the rest, and around 15%, which means here we have the graph showing that the most common type is chronic. So the most common patient is a male, the most common patient is with chronic type, okay? How many percent of chronic patients have hip pain? We said that 15% comes with knee pain. How many percent of chronic patients have hip pain, of chronic patients? 60%. So remember this, I've drawn this so you can remember it quickly. Stable or unstable, this is another classification. It is only discussing the displacement here. So epiphysis is not displaced from metaphysis. Walking is possible with crutches. Here we can see that the distinction, stable is not slipped, unstable is already slipped. In slipped one, we need to have a wheelchair for the patient. So the definition of unstable sleep is epiphysis is displaced from the metaphysis. And these are the parts which I always talking about. Diaphysis, metaphysis, epiphysis. The epiphysis is the upper part, metaphysis the middle part, and diaphysis is the lower part. The five types of classification, we continue with mild, moderate, severe. This is an interesting name, Southwick classification. We can also call it, this is just mild, moderate, or severe. It's relating to the degree of this slip or this angle of the slip. And we have less than 30, we have 30 to 50, and more than 50. And here we can see this. You see mild, less than 30, moderate, 30 to 50, and more than 50 is a severe type. This is Southwick classification. We have them in both lateral projection and anterior posterior projection. That's what I'm talking about when I say that we do an x-ray and I want them in two positions, x-ray from anterior, posterior, and lateral, because then you see this is how it looks like on the pictures. Typical, atypical. Atypical just means that we have this disease, this is an abbreviation, slip capital femoral epiphysis, plus risk factors. So if you have these together, then we have an atypical disease. And which are the risk factors? We have obesity, renal failure, radiation therapy, like, for example, cancer patients or cancer children, they get radiation therapy. Or endocrine disease, we have hypothyroidism, and genetic disease like Down syndrome. So here we have some pictures of obesity, of renal failure, of radiation, of hypothyroidism, and of Down syndrome. In which children should we suspect atypical disease? We have those which have a small for age height, and those which are younger than 10 years or older than 16 years. These are the atypical disease patients. Small for age, remember this. What do we have to do in patients we suspect have atypical disease? We do the lab test because we want to see if we have hypothyroidism. So we check the TSH. We want to check the kidney parameters because maybe it's kidney disease and so on. This is just showing we take blood from the patient and we check these lab values. Unilateral, bilateral. Bilateral just means both sides. Unilateral means one side. And the bilateral is around 30% of all patients, and unilateral is most of them. So you get mostly this disease in one hip, and then bilateral is in 30% only. And which hip is most affected by unilateral disease? Left hip. We don't know why left hip is most affected. Here you see that. How common is that a unilateral disease becomes a bilateral disease? 30%. So for every patient that has unilateral disease, one third of them will become bilateral. Here we have a picture of that. How many percent of patients with unilateral hip disease with endocrine disease will develop bilateral disease? Almost all, everybody. So if you have hypothyroidism and you have unilateral hip affected, then you can expect almost 100% that you will get it on both sides, because this is a risk factor. This is an atypical disease. This is the most more serious than the typical one. So unilateral plus endocrine in 99% bilateral. Complications. This is what I talked about, that if you do not treat, if the doctor does not recognize the disease in 4 months, we said, because he don't have a clue of this disease, then, and or the patient comes in with knee pain, and the doctor don't think of hip pain, then these things will happen. Avascular necrosis, which is very severe, chondrolysis, femoral acetabular impingement, and osteoarthritis. Let's look at them. Avascular necrosis, this just means that we have avascular, as you hear it in the name, no vascular system. Somehow the vascular system is not delivering the blood into this region of the bones. Yes, bones also need blood. And if they don't get blood, then they will totally be destroyed and they will collapse. And then they will break, and then you need total hip reconstruction and everything. And how often does avascular head necrosis occur with unstable slipped? It's 50%. So if you have an unstable patient, half of them can get avascular necrosis, half of them with unstable one. And we said stable was that the capital region is not slipped. Unstable was that it's already slipped. So is avascular necrosis more common in acute or chronic disease? Acute around 15%. And in chronic, it's even rare. So it's very, very rare. It's almost never happens. Acute, it means acute and unstable. Okay? So is avascular necrosis more common in stable or unstable disease? Unstable. So acute and unstable. Remember, that is the two most common reasons for avascular necrosis. What does patients with avascular necrosis usually complain about? Also pain, stiffness of the hip, but it's persistent. So it's not really, you cannot really distinguish it out just of the symptoms. What does patient with avascular usually complain about? We said this hip. How can we recognize this disease? Bone scan, x-ray, and MRI. All the same as we did for this disease in general. Here we see a bone scan, here we see an x-ray, and here we see an MRI. Chondrolysis, what does this mean? We have, this is also a complication. This is just a narrowing of the joint spaces and loss of the cartilage of the joint. How can chondrolysis be recognized? Also bone scan, x-ray, MRI. Here we see the bone scan, x-ray, MRI. So femoral acetabular impingement is the second, third complications. And here we have an abnormal contact between the epiphysis, so metaphysis, and the acetabular rim. Here you see an impingement. You see this is like a growing part that impinge, which means it just compresses the head, and therefore it cannot really move anymore. That is an impingement part that is, it should be like this, let's say, and now it's like this. What is the most common cause of femoral acetabular impingement? It's this disease. So that when we will do a presentation of that disease, we know that the disease we're talking about today is the most common cause of it. Last one, osteoarthritis. Osteoarthritis is the breakdown of joint cartilage. Here we can see a very nice picture, normal joint, and here when osteoarthritis with edema, inflammation, and destruction of the cartilages. Treatment. We want to treat it because we see otherwise we will get all these complications. We will do an operation. We need an operation with a screw, single cannulated screw, in the center of the epiphysis. This is how it looks like. This is what the orthopedic surgeons will do. And the other hip is always a question. Should we screw the other hip also? Because we know it takes around 18 months for it to become on the other hip also usually. No, please don't screw the other hip. Only observe the other hip, continually do a follow-up, do an x-ray and follow-up. And if necessary, then we'll do an operation on that too. And except for operation, what can we do? We can have a non-weight-bearing treatment, which means wheelchair, unfortunately, and bed rest until the patient gets an operation. So I have to say, I'm sorry for these children, but they have to be on a wheelchair because the weight of the patient will just destroy his joint further. And we need to stabilize the patient in a bed. For how long should the patient then walk with crutches after we have done this operation? 6 weeks. 6 weeks. Okay. Quick review. Most common disease is the slip capitofemoral epiphysis in teenagers, and is the most common hip disease. We have teenagers between 11 and 13. We said boys are affected around to 13.5, girls around 12. And we have two times more common in boys. It's typical that we have an overweight boy, so we have a fatty boy with fast growing boy. There's no trauma, so the patient does not complain of any trauma, and usually hip pain, but in 15% of cases also knee pain. We can see this Trendelenburg gait, which means that the patient is standing on, let's say, left leg, then the hip is lower on the other side. And we have, for example, some signs on the x-ray, blurry signs. We have a blanch sign of steel on x-ray also. We have the Klein's line, which means that it's not intersecting the epiphysis here. And then we have this ice cream slipped sign. And we do an operation with single cannulated screw on the hip. Then we observe the other hip also. And if necessary, then we do an operation on the other one also. And the patient needs to be in a bed or on a wheelchair, and they have to walk with crutches for more than 6 weeks, unfortunately. So I thank you very much for listening, and I hope that you now know a little bit more about this slip capitofemoral epiphysis. So thank you very much.